My name is Trish Brockbank, and I will be the moderator for tonight's Young Author Talk. I would like to welcome our student winners, their families, our staff members, and I would like to especially welcome our Superintendent Wanda Ortiz. Assistant Superintendents Ann Palmer, Matt Gangler, and Rhonda Young. You want to do it? I'd like to welcome and thank for coming our Board of Ed members. Please feel free to wave if you're here. We have President Eileen Felix, First President Julie Burgos, Second Vice President Cynthia Safiri, and our trustees, Mr. Hassan Ahmed, Mr. Brandon Garcia, Ms. Eileen Harmon, and Ms. Maria Malave. Please let's stand for the presentation of the colors by our Brentwood ROTC, followed by the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Thank you. You may be seated. Welcome into our Brentwood living room tonight for a night full of conversation and learning. This year's YA assignment was a little different. It did not contain a prompt. Students were asked to choose a completed piece of writing from their writing portfolio and reflect on what made their writing go from good to great. And then we asked them to TED Talk about it. Let me catch up a little. Some of the resources we provided students and staff for tonight's TED Talks included rubrics, planning sheets, and speaker guides. As a result, tonight you will see a scope of work that includes a variety of genres, topics, and styles. It spans across grades K through 11. It is a combination of live talks and digital talks, but most importantly, it demonstrates the learning of our author, whether it is insight into the author's writing process, awareness of our author's craft, an understanding of a genre, or an appreciation of a writing tool. So join me in my upholstered chairs, where we will welcome the youngest of our first guests, my kindergarten friends. So our kindergarten winners included Mateo, Alyssa, Stacy, Wilson, and Yorani. Is everybody here? And I'm going to play you their digital podcasts.
Mateo, can you read your story for us?
Wow, that's a great job, Mateo. Mateo, what did you do on every single page in your story? And what was the pattern in your writing? Great job, Mateo. Alyssa, what did you do to your picture to help with your writing?
Awesome. What kind of details did you put into your writing?
Wow, that was a great idea. And did that help to make your story better?
Yes.
And what else did you add to it?
A music box.
Awesome. What is a music box for?
That makes you sleep.
Oh, and does the music box help you to go to sleep?
Yes.
And what did you write on your paper?
Me sleeping in my bed. Is that what you drew a picture of, sleeping in your bed?
Wonderful. Can you read the words for me that you wrote?
I can sleep.
Great job, Alyssa.
Who's your teacher?
So Stacy, can you tell me who the character was in that story? Yes. Tell me. The dog. The cat. Excellent. Okay.
So did Tom help her?
No.
Why? Why wouldn't they help her? Were they busy doing other things?
Yes.
Yes. But at the end, did they help her or they did not?
Did not.
But did she share? What was she making anyway? What was the hen making?
Pizza.
Pizza. Did she share her pizza?
Yes.
Yes. Even though her friends didn't help her, she still shared. So, was that a kind thing to do?
Yes.
Yes, it was. Can you tell me what is happening with these illustrations here?
Yes.
Okay, tell me.
The hen is giving something to the other hen.
Okay. And what is this?
A house.
Whose house?
The little red hen.
Okay. And what was she doing in that house? What was she making?
Pizza.
Okay, now what happens on page two? Talk about your illustration. What's happening? What character is that?
The hen.
Okay, so what is the hen doing?
Holding the pizza.
Okay.
What's up here in the sky?
A sun.
It's beautiful.
Yeah.
And who's she giving the pizza to?
To a friend.
To her friends, okay. And what's happening on page three? We have who?
The dad bird.
Okay, and who's that?
The mom bird.
Okay.
What other characters are in your picture?
A cat and the dog and the bird.
And you wrote a word. What word did you write?
Yeah, what is that? Love. Love. Why did you put love there? Why?
Because we like it.
Who does?
The mom.
Oh, she loves what she did?
Yes.
Does she love all her friends?
Yes.
Okay, that's so nice. I love this. And page 4, what's happening here in this illustration? What are they going to do over here?
Eat.
Well, what is this?
The table and the chair.
Okay. And so, what do you think the little red hen will do now?
Share the bread.
Share the pizza? Okay. All right, nice. And all her friends are invited?
Yes.
Okay.
I see the rain. The rain drops water. In the earth, the cloud is full of water. I think because I like to fix my sentences, I like learning about weather. Actually, with Mrs. Hessel, the experiment I learned about the rain.
Hey, it's me, Ronnie. I'm the student at Southwest Elementary School to teach you how to be a great writer.
Hey, Ronnie, what grade are you in?
Kindergarten.
And who's your teacher?
Miss Plunkett.
So, Ronnie, how does a good writer write a story?
Capital letters, and finger spaces, and period.
And what things do you like to write about?
I like to write about my scooter, coloring beautiful pictures. Bye, guys. Happy writing to everybody.
Waves, everybody. Our kindergarten winners, Future Writers of America. Thank you. No. Yes. Great job. Great job. We learned how to write across 4 pages. We learned how to finger space. We learned how to add details to our pictures. Those are definitely Future Writers of America. Now let's fast forward to our students who are readying for commencement. Tonight's keynote speakers are 2 lovely young ladies from our high school here who will share with us their journey as writers. Ready to inspire our younger students and their families in the audience, please welcome Quill Award recipients, Farah and Zohia.
Let's just go there.
Good afternoon, everyone. I hope you guys are doing well. My name is Zohia Tahir.
Hi, my name is Farah Al-Zafarani, and a little to get to know me about me. I am 16. I am a junior at Brentwood High School. I am from Egypt, and I came to America in 2012, and I have 2 sisters, Lena and Noor. Lena is 19, and Noor is 12. My hobbies include baking, cooking, and especially biking, and my favorite subjects include math and English. My favorite foods include pizza, and some of the accomplishments I have acquired over the years include the NYIT Research Award, the Quill Awards, and Legislator Sarah Anker Award for my climate change advocacy.
Okay, this is a little to know me. So I am 17 years old, and I'm a junior at Brentwood High School. I am from Pakistan, and I came to America in 2017. My favorite hobbies are baking, reading, and playing badminton. My favorite sport is, of course, badminton, and I played in the varsity badminton team for 2 years at Brentwood High School, and I was number 1 singles on the girls' side. My favorite food is chicken parmesan. And lastly, some of the accomplishments I've earned these past years is winning NYIT Mini Research Grant 2, Quill Awards, an award from legislator Sarah Anker, and I've also won the Young Author Award.
So I love writing because I view it as a creative outlet. It is a way for me to unleash my creativity, allowing for the exploration of new worlds, characters, and ideas that exist beyond the confines of reality. This creative freedom is a source of my joy and fulfillment for me. Poems are my favorite to be creative, and I have a journal especially for that. Writing also serves for me as a self-expression. It is a way to convey my thoughts, feelings, and perspectives that may be difficult to articulate in everyday conversations. And this is why I have a personal journal, so I recommend everyone to do that too. I also love writing because it is a way that I could have an impact on others. I am driven by the potential impact of my words that I can have on the readers, whether it's offering comfort, sparking joy, or inspiring change. The possibility of touching someone else's life through storytelling is deeply motivating. Writing opinion pieces about current events at our school or around the world allows me to influence others. Finally, my passion for writing comes from escape and imagination. Writing is a way to escape the stress of high school, especially as a very overachieving teenager. This is the way I could relieve my stress at the end of the day. The way I do this is through science fiction stories.
Okay. Writing to me is more than just putting a pen to paper or fingers to keys. It's a creative outlet where I can pour out my thoughts, emotions, and ideas in unique and imaginative ways. Through writing, I discover new perspectives, explore the depths of my imagination, and ultimately express myself. In addition to my love for writing, I have the privilege of serving as the secretary of the English Honor Society. In this role, I have the opportunity to organize events like Book Buddies Day at Brentwood Public Library. This day is not just about books, it's about fostering connections. It's about bringing children and volunteers together to share the joy of reading and storytelling. Witnessing how storytelling brings people close together, developing not only a love for reading, but also strengthening communication skills and genuine connections, fills my heart with joy and reaffirms the power of words to unite us all. Writing to me is just not a hobby or a skill. It's a powerful tool for inspiration and education, whether it's through storytelling, informative pieces, or persuasive essays. Writing has the remarkable ability to spark change and shape opinions. Moreover, writing has been instrumental in my personal growth journey. It serves as a catalyst for continuous learning and self-reflection, pushing me to explore new perspectives, refine my thoughts, and expand my worldview. It's through writing that I discover more about myself and the world around me, constantly evolving and striving for betterment. In high school, books are like a break for all the work. My favorite thing is reading a book and then watching its movie or show version. This year, The Summer I Turned Pretty was my escape from school stress. So learning over the years. It all began when I arrived to the United States during sixth grade with limited English proficiency. Adapting to a new country and new challenges was a daunting challenge, one that I initially found overwhelming. Despite my efforts, I struggled in school, particularly in English classes, to the point where I was held back to fifth grade. It was a setback, a moment of disappointment, but little did I know that it would mark the beginning of a remarkable transformation. In fifth grade, I embarked on the journey of learning English. It was a journey filled with barriers and frustrations, but it was also a journey filled with determination and perseverance. Transitioning to middle school, I had the fortune of meeting Mrs. Lesterino, a middle school teacher whose dedication and support would change the course of my academic life. Mrs. Lesterino believed in me when I struggled to believe in myself. She provided dedicated support and tutoring after school, patiently guiding me through the difficulties of the English language. Under her mentorship, my English skills steadily improved, and with each passing day, my interest in learning the language grew stronger. From ENL, English as a new language classes, to regular classes, and eventually to honors and AP courses. Mrs. Lesterino's unwavering support paved the way for my academic success. Her mentorship was more than just educational guidance. It was a guiding light of hope that brightened my path forward. Today, as I stand before you, proficient in English and academically successful, I owe a debt of gratitude to Mrs. Lesterino. Her belief in me, her dedication, and her unwavering support played a pivotal role in my journey, transforming initial struggles into triumphs and adversity into the achievement.
Okay, so learning over the years, I came to the United States when I was in first grade, so I was a bit younger, but many of my peers already knew how to communicate in English while I was struggling because I only knew how to speak Arabic, and there was moments I couldn't express my thoughts, leading me to misbehave, and I was failing many of my classes because I could not speak English correctly or communicate with others. However, after taking ENL classes for until around fourth grade, I was able to learn English at my own pace and reach my proficient level by working very hard. I had to use the growth mindset to keep myself motivated and not become burnt out, and I still use this mindset till this day. This progress has led to my transition from ENL to regular English classes and eventually advancing to honors and AP, or advanced placement courses, by the sixth grade. I entered honors English by eighth grade, and by 10th grade, I was taking AP classes such as AP Seminar and AP Language and Composition. So my writing style. I love opinion pieces and I love advocating for the rights of others. I could be classified as a motivational, inspirational, and investigative writer, attempting to unfold the truths beyond the surface. This is shown when I wrote an article about the lack of guidance counselors and the inequality in halal food in Brentwood High School. My goal was to advocate for better support for the students here and allow us to get access to more opportunities. And with both those articles, I won the Quill Awards, one in 2023 and one in 2024.
I love to do creative writing because it allows me to unleash my imagination, craft stories, and explore endless possibilities within the realms of fiction and creativity. I enjoy working out with others and asking them what they find creative, gathering a bunch of different answers, which often sparks ideas for stories. Similarly, when I was curious about the differences between regular food and halal food, I went around asking people for their thoughts. It surprised me that many weren't familiar with halal food, so I decided to write an article about it, aiming to share this information with a wider audience.
So English Honor Society. I am an officer in English Honor Society. I am the president, and Zohia is a secretary. Every year, the English Honor Society collaborates with Student Council to organize a read aloud event open to anyone in the school community. This event offers the freedom to choose any piece to read aloud, empowering participants to express themselves and build confidence in public speaking. Additionally, our Book Buddies program, as previously mentioned, pairs high school members with younger students, providing opportunities for volunteering and fostering a love for reading through one-to-one interactions. The enthusiasm of our high school volunteer highlights the positive impact of these like initiatives on both our mentors and mentees alike.
So what are Quill Awards? Every year, Delphi University hosts Press Day, an exciting event where students, editors, reporters, and writers gather to showcase their talents and compete for recognition. This annual competition celebrates the diversity of writing, ranging from opinion pieces to short story. Throughout the day, participants engage in workshops, discussions, and networking opportunities. The result of Press Day is the eagerly awaited announcement for the winners, recognizing the outstanding talent and dedication displayed by students in journalism and creative writing. Press Day at Adelphi University serves as a platform for aspiring writers to shine and be celebrated for their hard work and dedication.
So what is our journey to the Quill Awards? And it all started with the high school newspaper, the Powwow. We became interested in the club and we started attending every meeting with Mr. Roderick and Ms. Bonaspia. Our involvement led us to assist others with the newspaper contributions and eventually sparked our interest to writing an article together. We decided to explore the school and ask students about the main issues they were facing. The predominant complaint was that there was an inequality between Ross and Sondering halal food offered at Brentwood High School. This inspired us to write an article focusing on improving halal food options and bringing this issue to the attention of the district.
To ensure the credibility and impact of our article on halal food, we cast a wide net for opinions. Interviews included our principal, Dr. Doolin, and representatives from the Halal Food Company. We also saw input from both Muslim and non-Muslim students for diverse perspectives. By incorporating viewpoints from various participants, our article aims to offer a comprehensive understanding of halal food within our school community, making it more influential and reliable.
So the second thing that we had to do to get our Quill Award was to have to include context. Not everyone knows about halal food, and we have to accommodate for that. So we first started off the article explaining what halal food was, and this is and why it's important to the growing Muslim population at Brentwood, because it's a very diverse place. And the second thing that we did was include visuals. As you could see, the picture on the top is a regular food day at Ross, and this was the halal food at Ross, but then the bottom is the halal food at Sonderling. As you can see, there's a very stark difference between the two, and without these pictures, the readers can't visualize the problem. And for me, and maybe probably many others, you could see that there is a big difference between the two, and we based not only based on these two pictures, we based on other pictures, and we created the article, and we created a data set for the readers to see the difference.
After conducting interviews and collecting relevant data, we began to write our article on halal food. We incorporated interviews, quotes, provided context on the issue, and included visual aids such as pictures or graphs. Once completed, we submitted our articles to the Quill Awards for consideration. And guess what? We won first place for the opinion piece.
These are some pictures of what our article looked like. So the first two are my guidance counselor article, and obviously this is not the full article, but this is just how the layout of how we submitted it. So the lessons learned. While it is amazing that we won for our article, it was the experience that we obtained that was the most valuable to us. We learned how to get out of our comfort zones and approach people that we would not talk to otherwise. We learned how to edit and take data through pictures, and finally we worked as a team, and we obtained a personal bond with each other, creating an everlasting friendship that I hope that will last forever.
So I just wanted to say thank you all for having us. Our message is simple: prioritize your learning and growth more than anything else. With a growth mindset, dedication, and hard work, you can achieve anything. As immigrants who face challenges with English and assimilating in the American world, we understand firsthand. But remember, if you set your mind to something, you can accomplish it. Believe in yourself. You've got this.
Thank you.
Thank you, ladies. Everyone. That was absolutely inspiring.
Okay. Thank you so much.
Okay. Yeah, thank you. So that's the journey. Let's talk a little bit about what a TED Talk is and maybe a little history about TED Talks and TED. TED is an acronym that stands for Technology, Entertainment, and Design. In 1984, Richard Saul Wurman observed and created what he thought would be a one-off conference that showed the powerful convergence of these three fields. The conference included a demo of the compact disc, the e-book, cutting-edge 3D graphics from Lucasfilm, and mathematician Benoit Mandelbrot, who demonstrated how to map coastlines using his theory of fractal geometry. First, the conference lost money. It wasn't until 1990, 6 years later, that it was reinvigorated and began to take off as an annual invite only in Monterey, California. TED offshoots included TED Global, TED Prize, TED Ed, TED Radio Hour, and more. The well-known TED Talks were first posted online on June 27, 2006, and within 3 months of the release, these TED Talks had reached more than 1 million views. Some fun facts. A TED Talk is limited to 18 minutes. This limit was determined based on neuroscience and strategy. It is believed 18 minutes is just enough time for a speaker to flesh out an idea, but short enough for a listener to understand and digest the information. Don't worry, for tonight's purpose, we've limited them for 5 minutes. The first TED Talk to reach 10 million views is Sir Ken Robinson. His TED Talk was titled, Do Schools Kill Creativity? This remains to be the most watched TED Talk today. TED Talks are currently subtitled in over 100 languages, and TED is always looking for volunteers to help translate. And did you know the tagline for TED is ideas worth spreading? So with that, let's continue with Brentwood Winners' great ideas. This segment of our TED Talks tonight will speak to what the authors learned about two writing genres, informational and opinion pieces. Please join us in the living room. Sarah has a digital talk about how she improved her book review with reasons and details. Come on up. I'm gonna come up this way. Give it a click. Thank you.
Yeah.
Come on, have a seat.
In writing workshop, I learned about writing my opinion about books. I wrote about how I felt about the book I read. I included reasons why I liked it. Finally, I know opinion writers add details about the book, so I did that too. Now I'm going to read my story. Today I read Olivia's First Serve. I think this book is very cool because Olivia cheers for Sarah. When she was surfing, Olivia is a good friend. She likes to talk about surfing. One reason I like this book is because Olivia wants to learn how to surf, like Sarah. I really like this book, and I think you should read it too.
You want to wave to the audience? Let's wave. Good job, Sarah. Next up is Sebastian. Sebastian is sharing how he revised his opinion writing. You want to sit on the chair over there? Or are you going to stand up here? Wait, stand with me, because you're going to talk, right? Test. There you go.
Can I get a round of applause for someone?
My name is Sebastian Quintanilla, and I am in first grade. I wrote my opinion about summer is the best season because I can do many things. I thought some people liked better. I added sticky notes to show you cannot do those things in the winter. You can do it in the summer. Don't forget to add details so the reader can you. Don't forget to reread your stories better.
So, Sebastian, before you go too far, I just want to point out to you that thinking about the opposite opinion when you're writing an opinion piece is actually grade 8 skill work. So you are advanced, my friend. So next we have Matthias, accompanied by his lovely principal, Ms. Burday. Matthias will share how text features and punctuation make nonfiction writing better.
They changed it. Now can we start?
Yep, 1 minute. Testing. Testing.
Talk louder.
Testing.
Screen.
So this is Matthias, and a fun fact about Matthias is that he is actually the youngest student at Southeast Elementary School. And Matthias wrote about tarantulas, a topic that he's very interested in. Matthias, you ready to share about the author?
Yeah.
Okay, go ahead.
I am Matthias. I am 6 years old. I love to play on my tablet and use my learning books. I like to go to the playground and see my friends. I like learning about tens and ones in math. I like to read fiction books like The Cat and the Hat. My favorite season is winter because it snows. I am learning Japanese. I can read in English and Spanish.
Ready? Let's turn the page. And here's Matisse's cover page, all about tarantulas. And Matthias, remember, for this part, I'm going to be the teacher, and you're going to be? Okay. So, why did you include a table of contents in your writing?
I added the table of contents so the reader can know where to go to find the pages they want to learn about.
What writing strategies did you use to make your writing better?
I added commas and a list on this page. I added labels so the readers know what the pictures are about.
After editing, what did you add to your writing to make it even better than it was before?
I added labels. I added labels to my picture. I put in a question at the bottom. The question says, "Can you believe it?" My question makes the reader feel surprised and excited. Body.
How did you improve this page after editing?
I added labels picture of the tarantula's body parts. I put a big wow.
Why did you add a big wow when you edited?
So the reader can be super, super surprised when the tarantula's by the tarantula's body parts. It has so many eyes.
What did you add to this page when you edited?
I added a bold word and I wrote what the bold word means too.
That is a great nonfiction text feature you included in your writing, Matias.
I forgot to say I labeled too.
Oh, sorry. All right, go ahead.
Wait.
You ready? Okay. Catches me every time. That is a great nonfiction text feature you included in your writing, Matias. Why did you include it?
Bold words make the reader know the word is important. I told the reader what the bold word means, too.
We learned so much. We learned about so many craft moves. Which craft move did you use on this page?
We learned about comparing. I compared the tarantula to a chicken because it helps the reader know two animals that lay eggs.
Excellent job, Matias.
Thank you, Ms. Burday and Matias. That was a little bit more than I ever needed to know about tarantulas, though. So our next segment of the TED Talks tonight is about the writer's process. We're going to take a close look at how authors, what they're thinking, what they're doing when they're writing, how they're revising, and the different steps into the writing process. And our first presenter is Diami. Okay. Earlier this year, New York State released the Literacy Briefs, which discusses the strong connection between reading and writing. Reading fuels the writer with ideas, language, and ways to construct and illuminate the written piece's purpose. Writing promotes a deeper understanding of any text, further building language, knowledge, not communication skills for both home language students and English language learners. Diami and her information and her presentation showed this very close connection between reading and writing as she dove deep into recognizing themes in texts.
Hi, my name is Diami, and I'm an eighth grader at East Middle School. I've been writing essays all my life. I love reading and writing and try to be the best that I can be at all times. Writing can be difficult for kids today. Today, I'm going to share the steps I used and followed that really helped me improve. This year, my amazing English teacher, Miss Minkus, had us read the book Monster by Walter Dean Myers. The novel is about this teenager named Steve Harmon that was faced with a difficult situation. He was accused of involvement with a man who got shot and killed in a grocery store. When I finished the whole book, I was assigned this writing project, a PowerPoint presentation on themes from the book. We had to find the themes of the book and incorporate a song or poem that demonstrated it. In my PowerPoint, I used themes of loss of honor and identity crisis. The protagonist, Steve Harmon, faced so many difficulties in this book that I just felt compelled to write about it. My process of describing the themes in the songs that I included took a while, but I am an eighth grader and I've been doing this for years. The writing process starts off with creating a good foundation, or another way of saying that is planning and collecting all of our information. Because if what you write is all over the place and doesn't make sense, then your reader is either going to think a little kid wrote it for you, or you simply do not care about your writing at all. Your main goal with writing is to get the reader engrossed and impressed by your work. During my project, when I began drafting, I had made sure to check up with my friends about my work. If you really want to improve the way you write, you need to ask for opinions, ask your teacher or peers to read the writing in order to give constructive criticism or feedback on it. Okay. Revising is our next step. Revising is carefully reading over the work and adding or removing items that do not allow the piece to flow. Many students read aloud. To reiterate, we carefully read the book, peruse songs related to the theme, and analyze lyrics. You want to make sure that you included quotes from the book to develop your main point in your draft. In my project, I use a lot of what Steve, the protagonist, wrote and felt about his life in his journal. Incorporating the quotes helped the reader view what the character was feeling. This causes a connection with the reader. In other words, it's crucial to use the information from all of your sources in order to do the assignment correctly. You want to make sure you paraphrase correctly and cite your sources. You also want to make sure that you never bore the reader by repeating your words. It wouldn't be fun to read anyone's essay if they repeated phrases as to start with or to begin with, and ended the essay with in conclusion constantly. The reader would think that you were not creative or could not connect the words. So we fixed that by exploring with transition words and mixing stuff up. One word that I always seem to be repeating is because, so I used the thesaurus and searched up other ways to utilize. Now for editing. I sometimes mess up what I'm writing and I don't notice it or get lazy and don't want to fix it, but that's why you need to edit your work. Editing is very important to fix your mistakes and strengthen your writing. In order to improve your writing, you need to read it to yourself and make sure that there are complete sentences and capitalization. Our final step is publishing. If you follow the writing process fully, then publishing is a breeze. Make sure you rewrite and place on a clean sheet of paper after you reread. Just like that, you are a writer. Now give yourself a pat on the back and share what you wrote with everyone. Thank you for listening.
So that's my fault. I was a little slow. But I do want to share earlier in the slide, because Dayami just gave me the signal a little too late. This is where her text connects in her theme.
Stand in the mirror, you look the same. Looking for shelter from cold and pain. Someone to cover, safe from the rain. To be home.
That's where the text-to-text connection comes in that I thought was so excellent. So thank you very much. Sorry about this. A little technical difficulty here. Okay. So now we have Kaylin, who's coming up to the stage where she continues to talk about the writer's process and explains how she sees improvement in her own writing when she revises.
Hello?
What do you see when you think of this picture? Arguing, debating, fighting? Any of these responses make sense, but as you can see, the picture suggests that someone has said something rude, making this a total argument. It would be better if the two people went back in time to fix what they said, right? This conversation looks so much more casual and improved. Well, that's what it felt like when I learned how to revise my writing. Hi there, I'm Kaylin, and I want to talk about the improvement that shows when you revise your writing. In my past years, I've always just written my work, not looking over, seeing if I can make any final edits. I normally know that I always make spelling mistakes or grammatical errors, but I never seem to fix them before I handed in a writing assignment. But this year in English class, I had to revise a draft. A part of the draft sounded out of topic and repetitive. For example, I repeated the phrase as we or as there 6 times in a 5 paragraph essay. And spelling mistakes were all over the place. Looking back at that, I'm so happy I had class time to look over it. I needed to fix so much, even though at the start, when I wrote it, I thought I did amazing. This book, Refugee, made by Alan Gratz, has inspired my editing for my draft. His work has so many perspectives, and in the end, it connects. I use this book as a reference. I focus on how he wrote the character's perspective and the way he wrote it. And I looked at my work to see if it matched up with his writing. Somehow some parts of my writing didn't match up with the way Alan Gratz had written the character's perspective in the book. For example, when I wrote, Mahmoud's perspective is to stay cautious and avoid problems. I realized that it didn't sound right, so I decided to change it. As you can see, in my revised essay, I wrote, Mahmoud's perspective is that the world is dangerous and to stay cautious. This made more sense to me. Also, this was a good tip I learned. Always read your work out loud and to yourself multiple times. It might sound good to yourself, but once you read it out loud, you start to see mistakes you can fix. I read it to my friends, and they said it was great, but to me, there were so many mistakes I could have fixed. Plus, if you can get a friend to help you out, they might point out some things, mistakes you have. After I changed some of my draft, it was much improved and organized. And once again, my tip is to reread to yourself and read out loud to others. These inspirations and tips helped me so much, and I hope you can consider them into your writing. Thank you so much for listening, and I hope you have a wonderful night. Thank you.
So continuing with the writing process, thank you, Caitlin, that was excellent, is Elijah. And Elijah's going to share with us a little bit about how he does some peer editing as well. Come on up. We have you digitally, right? We have you digitally. Watch. I'm going to play your, you want to have a seat? Yeah, okay.
My name is Elijah Fuentes in Northeast Elementary School, and I'm in fourth grade, and my teacher is Mr. Murphy. Did you know there are many important steps to writing, such as organizers, hooks, and examples? In my opinion, someone checking your writing and telling you what mistakes you have is an especially important step to writing. One reason someone checking your writing is important is because if you are writing about something, your teacher may offer you to partner with someone. If you partner with someone, the partner can check your work and tell you the mistakes you have. Furthermore, someone checking your writing is important because they give you strong words to improve your writing. For example, fight can be changed to battle. Additionally, someone checking your writing is important because if you forget to indent, add a word, or punctuation, they can remind you so that your edited piece looks perfect. In conclusion, someone checking your work is an important step to writing.
Big bow for that one. Yeah. Very good. Thank you very much. Okay. So next comes Jason, my friend Jason. He's going to provide us with some help when we experience a well-known obstacle for all writers. In fact, I had this just the other day when I was trying to write some of this script tonight. It's called writer's block. So go ahead, Jason, whenever you're ready.
Have you ever experienced writer's block? Have you ever thought about the choice of your words? Young Author by Jason Bonilla. Hi. My name is Jason Bonilla. I am a fourth grader in Frank J. Cannon Southeast Elementary School. I personally think writing is very useful and enjoyable as it can help you focus more on things. It helps your imagination flow. Writing can improve your handwriting. One of my favorite writers is Dr. Seuss. I love and enjoy Seuss's words. His rhymes are funny and more enjoyable when used. Here are some photos of my story, It Takes Courage to Make a Difference, when I had used descriptive language. When I look at my own writing, I notice and see my descriptive language. It helps the reader imagine what I'm talking about. For example, in my story, It takes courage to make a difference. I use words such as gigantic, furious, shocked, and rushed. These words are a part of descriptive language and help support the fact that I create imagery a lot of times in my writing. These details help the reader know what the writer is talking about and create an image in their mind. This is important as otherwise the reader would not understand what they are reading. At times, I have been in a writer's block. I couldn't think of a story when I had to. I was stuck. I tried harder and harder. Then I had remembered when I found out my dog had escaped. My writer's block had been cured. The story had grown to one of my most memorable stories, known as A Dog That Escaped. These details shows that if you think hard enough, you can do it and make it through a writer's block. I've had multiple writer's blocks, yet I made it through all of them by thinking hard enough and got through it and made delightful stories that grew to be seen by the school and public and many others. If I had to help a writer in writer's block, I'd tell them what was or is the most memorable thing you've experienced and what things you enjoy or like to do. This can help a writer in writer's block as they get reminded of what they enjoy in the first time they've tried it. Also, many things they think are memorable could be used as a story. Thank you for listening to my presentation and have a good night.
Thank you, that was excellent. That's great. So I think we're all cured now with our writer's block. That is a relief. Our next presenter, Joseph? Joseph is gonna come up and talk to us. He is not lazy when it comes to writing, that's for sure, because he's gonna talk about multiple drafts, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay, so come on up. Let me get you up on the screen here. You ready?
Yep.
Joseph, hit it.
Welcome aboard the Long Island Railroad, New York commuters. We are on board a very special train line today. So, I have a question for all of you guys out there. Has your class ever sent a message to a person or a company? In school, my class read Along the Santa Fe Trail by Ginger Wadsworth. We had to send a letter to the Santa Fe Trail Historical Society. The letter was written to ask questions about what we read. We had to write three drafts, a sloppy draft, a revised draft, an edited draft, and the final project. At first, I was worried about if I was really going to write a letter, as it was my first time. This will change soon, a thought I never have until now. For the first draft, I tried, but not so hard, as I knew that I would be editing and revising my writing. For the second draft, that's when I started editing what I wrote. I crossed out filler words so that the letter would be more on to the point, as some people would say. The third draft was the finale, where it all comes together. This is the point where I tried my hardest. I shared this draft with my teacher, and I just had to change up some last words. I am going to be totally honest here. I enjoyed the last part more. Not because it was the end, but because all of your hard work comes to a high point. It gives you a challenge that encourages yourself. I always made sure to evaluate myself to check if my writing is good enough. You can ask yourself questions like, are there any capitalization errors? Or does this sound right? And more. Sorry. My name is Joseph Somar. I'm a writer in the fifth grade. In my opinion, writing helps us grow in a lot of ways. Want to apply for a job? Writing. Want to get into college? Writing. Want to cash in for your lottery win? Writing. See my point? Abbreviations like LOL or OMW came from writing as well. There's a lot of things writing is important for. Even writing helps your health by strengthening your finger. What I'm saying is that writing is one sure way that you're going to get further in life. That's why I enjoy it. Here's your stop. Oh, and I hope you get my point in that writing is a very good way to help yourself in a lot of different ways. Happy writing! Oh, yeah.
Excellent! All aboard! Thank you, Joseph. So the next segment of our TED Talks tonight is all about the tools of writing. First, we'd like to thank the Dictionary Project, the Rotary Club, for the Dictionary Project that they do every year for us. President Jackie Meriwether and past presidents Rose and Lou Brousseau for their commitment to supporting our literacy initiatives. Every year, the Rotary purchases dictionaries for all our third grade students in the district. It is a valuable tool that students need to aid their writing. We know that the effects of their generosity impact hundreds of children each year and help our students enrich their writing. So thank you to the Rotary Club for that. Our next guest, our next TED Talk, I should say, is writing about the how technology is a tool. And we have Franceline with us. And I believe her presentation is digital. So, Franceline, wherever you want to sit, go ahead. If you want to sit with the teddy bear, go ahead. Go right ahead, and I'm going to play her TED Talk, and she's giving us a lesson on how technology is a great tool.
My name is Ransomy, and in this PowerPoint, I will tell you how I did my research about Martin Luther King. You might learn some ways that technology and research can help you with stories. Let's head into the portal of my research. First, I had to know my topic to know what to type in the search bar. I decided to talk about MLK, so I typed facts about Martin Luther King Jr. This is the results they gave me. Next, I noticed people's asks help me get ideas of what to add onto my story. Sometimes I just need to know what other people ask so I can add even more facts about MLK. Other people and I can even learn new things with people's asks. Then I noted down my favorite facts. I like to include interesting facts in my writings if I am writing something nonfiction. But a story like this included technology. Usually I find facts without technology, but this is still a nice way to find notes for your story. But first, I actually thought about which facts would entertain most people, and I made sure I knew what those facts meant, so I could explain it more to make my story more interesting. After a lot of thought, I started to create. When I didn't know what a word meant, you know what rescued me? The computer. I didn't know what improvise meant, so I searched it up and I got an idea of the definition. The worst part was I couldn't add every single favorite fact of mine, so I decided to pick the best ones. It was tricky. I thought I got stuck, because I thought, will my favorite facts entertain most people, or will I have to think even more about the readers? I thought both. I picked a favorite fact of mine and asked myself, do most people know this fact? I like to pick facts most people don't know, so they will be drawn into my story. By the way, this is the steps I follow. You can also do this too. I only done the top two. I bet I can do the bottom two. When I finish the end of my portal, the more ideas I get, the longer the portal is. What ideas are in your portal?
Franceline! That was beautiful.
The end, and thank you for listening.
That was beautiful. I love the graphics in your TED Talk. Do you have help? Anybody help you? A little bit? Who helped you? Mr. Mio helped you? Wave to Mr. Mio. I know he's here. Thank you, Franceline. That was excellent. So our next TED Talk is further connecting the relationship between reading and writing. She's going to talk about a high-level strategy and skill that helps make learning permanent through summarizing. Isabella is going to share her 10% strategy that helps her learn. Hi, Isabella.
Hi, how you guys doing? Okay. My name is Isabella Perdomo, and I'm a sixth grader from West Middle School. Has anyone tried to write something and just didn't know how? Well, I finally found a way. Creating a topic sentence with Collins' 10% summary. Imagine you go to a bookstore, perhaps Barnes & Noble, and pick out a book. When you look at the back, there's a summary about the book. A summary is a shorter version of a larger text. In other words, a summary is a brief description of the main events of work written in your own words. You skipped the slide by accident. What is Collins' 10% summary? Collins' 10% summary is when the writer uses an acronym START to develop a topic sentence. S stands for source. Source is a genre of the text. Some examples include historical fiction, science fiction, poems, fantasy, and nonfiction. Title. T stands for title. In every summary you write, you must mention the title. A title is the name of a book, song, movie, or any other text. In other words, examples include Hachiko, the true story of a loyal dog, Schooled, and This Is Not a Drill. Author. A stands for author. The author is the person who wrote the book. Reasoning. Authors are listed on their books to give credit for their work. It wouldn't be fair to the authors who took the time to create a book. Some examples include Sarah J. Maas, Rania Telgemeier, and Carrie Ann Holt. Write verb. R stands for write verb. A write verb is the author's purpose. An author can't create a book without a purpose. Some examples include explains, persuades, describes, and argues. Think of the story Hachiko, the true story of a loyal dog. The author, Pamela S. Turner, explains the life of Hachiko and his master, Dr. Ueno. Topic. T stands for topic. A topic is the theme or subject of whatever you are reading or writing. This step will determine the rest of your steps, what your statement is, what sources you use, and how to write your paper. So it's important to make sure you choose a strong and engaging topic. When you use Collins' 10% summary, your summary should be similar to this. In the historical fiction, Hachiko, the true story of a loyal dog, the author Pamela S. Turner explains the life of Hachiko and his master, Dr. Ueno, and how they are loyal to each other. Thank you for listening. If you would like to learn more about this topic, visit collinsed.com. Have a good day.
Excellent. Thank you so much. That was excellent. Very good job. Okay. So we're starting our descent. And for our final segment of the evening, and one of my favorites, the writer's craft. We will learn about precise writing moves and considerations that our authors needed to execute in order to make their writing become great and how teachers help them get there. Nina, come to the stage. Nina and I are going to chat about how she made her poem pop with imagery. You don't have my questions? Oops. Nina, you want to read your poem first?
I have my poem.
You have your poem? Okay, you want to read it?
Warm summer day. People hitting the volleyball over the net. My cousins splashing each other in the water. Black bathing suit made just for her. Strawberry ice cream dripping down my hand. Going with Gianna to splash in the public pool by Nina.
Wow. That is a beautiful poem. Nina, can you tell me, what did you learn as an author of poetry?
I learned that not all poems need to rhyme. I also learned that poems can be broken up into stanzas. Poems can be written with short phrases. They don't always need to be written in complete sentences.
That is so true. Thank you so much for sharing that information. What did you do to improve your poem?
I learned that I should use sensory details in my poem. I wrote about what I saw, tasted, heard, and felt in the summertime. Sensory details help the reader create images or pictures in their minds. I used alliteration in my poem, such as black bathing suit and public pool. This creates an effect. Lastly, I used the Revisit Your Writing Rules checklist as a guideline to make sure my writing was the best I could do.
And it certainly was, wasn't it? Yes! Thank you so much. I learned so much about writing poetry. I really loved your alliteration, too. Alliteration's my favorite.
Thank you.
Thank you, Nina. Wait for your teacher. Okay, now we have Jackson. Jackson's going to come up and talk to us about how he hooks the audience. Come on over here. Sure.
Ah.
Got that?
It's my Is that your first page?
Okay, good. All right, hold on. Let me get it up. Can you give me a click? Is that you?
Good evening. My name is Jackson Argetta, and I am from Twin Pines. I am a second grade student in Mrs. Sackle's class. I will be talking about how to hook your reader. Good stories always have an interesting beginning. It's called a hook because, like fishing, you want to hook your reader. One way to write a good hook is to start with a question, or you could have an action, or maybe you could use a surprising fact. I am going to show you how I use different types of hooks to write my story about the time I went to Disney. Here is my question hook. Have you ever been to the funnest place on earth? Then I tried an action hook. My dad jumped in the car, shut the door, and then we're on our way to Disney. Last I wrote a surprising fact. Did you know Disney is the world's most popular family resort? I got it. Now I will show you how I took my writing from good to great with my new hook. I thought about which hook I liked the best. In my first draft of my story, my hook had a feeling. I described that it was so fun. But then I reflected and used one of my new hooks to write to make my writing better. I changed my hook to a surprising fact. Thank you for listening to my TED Talk. Have an awesome night.
Excellent! Jackson, that was great. Here, take. Thank you. So that was Jackson. Now we have Matthew. And Matthew is an actual published author. Come on up, Matthew. Matthew's going to tell us about his journey as a writer, right?
When Mills Wilkins first told me I was going to write a 100-word mini-saga, my mouth went wide open. My brain thought 100 words were a lot, but then I remember in the past when I took the nicest lap, and then thought 100 words wouldn't be that much after all. When I heard I was entering the Young Writers Contest, I was frightened about the fact that other people are going to see my essay and judge it. I never thought I could win a contest. The things that inspired me to write this story is seeing on YouTube about the old schools from the 1900s and seeing these gadgets that can detect ghosts and paranormal activity. I always fascinated with spooky old buildings that might be haunted. My favorite part in the process was making up the story and fascinating words to make it spookier. And I also enjoyed making the characters like real people and what emotions they would have in that situation. The most challenging part of the spooky essay was making the words important and making it stand out to the reader. I only had 100 words to work with, so every word had a count. It was important to use words that create imagery to the reader. The challenging part was making the words important and interesting because I can only use 100 words. I had to make sure I used words that create a spooky tone. Sometimes I would have less words or more words than I was supposed to have, so that was frustrating sometimes. For example, I wrote the words, "The teacher's heart raced as a ghostly hand reached out from the walls." I thought these words would give the reader an image of his mind and feeling of suspense. I'm going to be a published writer. My feelings went through the roof. When I got a letter from young writers informing me I will be publishing a book called Haunted, along with other students around the country who submitted mini sagas. At first, I had hope and anxiety since my spooky saga was going to be judged by other older people. I didn't believe it would be published. I thought in my mind they were just saying the typos or encouraged us to write it as good as possible. I told my parents and they even felt more emotions. My advice for the people who might struggle with the writing assignment is to understand the assignment or maybe get help from the teachers around you to help you understand the assignment. My other advice is to manage your time with the essay and edit your work several times to make the word stand out and spooky. I feel like I will be able to write another spooky saga, but if it's a different topic, I don't think I will be able to write it. The haunted school teacher. The classroom clock struck midnight, but the teacher remained, grading papers in the dim, flickering light. Suddenly, a ghostly whisper echoed through the room, chilling her to the bone. The textbook on the shelves levitated and opened, pages rustling in a spectral breeze. Then from the chalkboard, a message materialized in blood-red letters, "You're not alone." The teacher's heart raced as a ghostly hand reached out from the walls, cold and clammy, closing in around her. She screamed, but no sound escaped her lips. The classroom had become a nightmarish prison for her. And thank you for your time for coming here and listening to my mini saga experience.
Wow, that is an excellent mini saga. And I loved all of your images in that piece of writing. Sounds like you're the next Quill Award winner.
Thank you.
Good job. Okay. Now, as a tribute to Black History and Women's History Month, Brianna will discuss the power of the written word. Brianna.
Hello. Hi, everyone. Today, I want to walk you guys through the power of descriptive writing through the lens of my old writing piece, Black Women in History. This writing piece isn't only about your typical informational fourth grade presentation. It's about how the power of descriptive writing can empower and transform your ordinary writing piece into something extraordinary. I'm Brianna Taylor, just a girl who's determined and ready for challenges. I've always loved to write and vividly imagine stories in my head. This writing piece is my main example of descriptive writing. Descriptive writing isn't just about creating pretty pictures with words you found off of Google. It's about capturing the writing piece in its entirety. It's about capturing emotions and experiences in a way that resonates with your readers. I want to inspire others to feel that descriptive writing changes the thrill, the emotion, and the comparison between you and the writer. Well, Brianna, why is this piece a descriptive and a prime example of descriptive writing? Well, here's why. I wrote from the Civil War to civil rights activists and to this new age. I could have just wrote, throughout time, we have fought for our rights. Sounds bland, am I right? But it's not written like that. I have simultaneously been improving throughout my school career. I think what I did well was descriptive wording, a lot of details, a well-written script, and right wording for the right moment. Pray for those who despise you like Ruby, shoot for the stars like Mae Jemison, lead like Harriet Tubman, stand up for what's right like Rosa Parks, be empathetic like Maya Angelou, and be brave like Bernice Amor. Wow, younger me really impressed sixth grade me. I always had thought about the main characteristics. What words describe them best? What phrases fit these women best? That's where I produce, shoot for the stars, stand up for what's right. How did each word and phrase influence little boys and girls? What have these civil rights activists done to inspire them? But descriptive writing goes beyond than just influence. It's about inspiration. So what details can inspire the readers to understand the power of descriptive writing? This slide is about details, a lot of them. For instance, these women have shown little boys and girls that no matter what we look like, we still have the same passion as everyone else in this beautiful world. I swear I thought I was gonna be the next Maya Angelou, like obviously. But how? I want to inspire and strive in descriptive writing. I wrote this because I genuinely believe that these black women have improved the way we think. These women showed perseverance, patience, courage, bravery, and compassion. We all as people can have an impact on the world, but that comes with challenges and ordeals. Talking about challenges and ordeals, this piece was also one of them. Another point of descriptive writing is about being well-scripted, which I think I did well, primarily because of this sentence. It's people like these women who have led the way for femininity, political, and civil rights, from the Civil War to civil rights activists and to this new age. No matter what background you come from, you can still make a big difference. I wrote this because I ultimately thought that women like Ruby Bridges, Mae Jemison, and Rosa Parks, and many more women have paved the road piece by piece, little by little. We all come from an enriched background, and we can all make a huge difference. My thought process was, how can I include all the things in my writing piece and make it better? How can I let all the readers know that these women and us can make a difference if we try? I have a dream. Nothing is impossible. Inspiring, right? Martin Luther King definitely knows about this topic. Right wording for the right moment. I believe I have embraced this talent, primarily because these women have shown little boys and girls that no matter what we look like, we still have the same passion as everyone else in this beautiful world. Pray for those who despise you like Ruby, shoot for the stars like Mae Jemison, lead like Harriet Tubman, stand up for what's right like Rosa Parks, be brave like Bernice Amor, and be empathetic like Maya Angelou. My thought process when writing this was, which words could I use to describe these extraordinary women that would honor their great achievements and allow their stories to live on forever? This is Brianna Taylor, and I hope you enjoyed my piece about how descriptive writing matters and can inspire, influence, and transform ordinary writing pieces into descriptive masterpieces. And remember, writing inspired me to keep on going.
Wow. Brianna, that was beautiful. Thank you. Our final TED Talk tonight is an important one. My pal Caesar here is very smart and knows a lot of science stuff. His talk is about knowing your audience so that they understand you. And thank goodness he learned this lesson, because I wouldn't have known anything he was speaking about. Caesar, bring us home and talk to us about quantum cosmology. Cosmology?
Yeah.
Okay.
Well, quantum cosmologists, quantum mechanics, Kardashev scales. These words are music to my ears. Hello, I'm Cesar de Leon Girola, a fifth grade student from North Elementary School. One day, I was writing about my dream job. I grew that I wanted to be a quantum cosmologist. As I was revising, I realized that I included vocabulary words that were very complicated, and I hadn't thought that people might have a complicated time trying to understand those difficult vocabulary words. After that, I asked myself, how can I make my writing more understandable to my audience? One of the words that I realized people might have trouble with was quantum cosmologists, which was all my paper about. I realized that I had to give examples and definitions for scientific words to make my writing more easier to understand. For example, I had to explain that quantum cosmologist is a person who studies the past, the present, and the future about the universe. Easy, right? Finding meanings and examples for these difficult vocabulary words was a challenge for me. I knew what they meant, but I had to find ways that would be more suitable for people that are not familiar with quantum mechanics, let's say. I researched different definitions, examples, until I found those that would make my writing as clear as water to my audience. I want to share with you that there's a lot that you can learn from revising. You can become a better writer if you start on focusing on one thing that you want to make better. I learned that if you would like to improve your writing, you need to know your audience. Make sure to take the considerate amount of time to change your writing. If you know that you're using complex vocabulary words, be sure, again, to include definitions, examples, to help your audience understand exactly what you meant. Thank you for your time.
Very good. Thank you so much. I learned so much from you. You gonna take it a bow?
And I just want to say a special thanks to my dad that brought me here, to Mrs. Soldano and Mrs. Calvello, who are amazing teachers for
me. Great job. That was excellent. So before we present the medals for our winners who have been waiting patiently, I'd like to give a few special thanks to my colleagues in the curriculum office, especially Mary Taby, Teresa Jacalone, Noreen Miller, John LaSalle, Anne-Marie Madsen, and Laura Mihit. I'd like to thank the building administration team in grades K through 8 for supporting the contest, as well as our reading consultants, the library media specialists, the digital literacy teachers, and the MTSS teachers who are supporting this work in the buildings. I'd like to thank the Teacher Center for helping us laminate these beautiful pictures that Teresa Jacalone took. For the families whose child is portrayed up here, feel free to carefully remove that and take that home with you as a memento. And of course, none of this technology would even be possible without our IT department and our music department who helped set us up today. Thank you all, friends. So now, the big finale. We are going to begin calling the winners up to the stage to present the medals. Ms. Mary Taby will begin calling the names, and what we will do is we will start with grade 8. They're going to come up on this side of the stage. They're going to walk across the stage. They're going to get their medal from our dignitaries in the room, and then they're going to exit out that door, and there will be teacher ushers that are going to walk them around, and behind this black curtain are risers, and we're going to line everyone up for a big group picture at the end. Are there any other notes I need to say? To help present the medals, please come up, our Board of Education and our assistant superintendents.
Adrian Amaya. Alyssa Romero Dominguez. Mateo Andrade Larin. Samara Escobar. Sammy Ula. Wilson Castro Morales. Mia Velasquez Galdamez. Damian Duncan. Samantha Blanco. Selena Menshaw. Lauren Solis Cotto. Casey Romero Guzman. Nina Rowe. Jamie Gonzalez Rivera. Josiah Velasquez. Jasmine West. Daniel Fuentes. Sarah Hernandez. Alejandra Ramirez Molina. Jahir Reyes Portillo. Natalie Mendez Garcia. Sebastian Quintanilla. Ashley Jian. Christian Morganti. Kelvin Acosta Umanzor. Cesar De Leon Garola. Brian Chica Rodriguez. Usman Qureshi. Emery Gonzalez. Elijah Fuentes. Fernando Chacon Menendez. Jacon Londano. Billy Grace Daniels. Franceline Pierre Lewis. Rebecca Serrano. Samira Tejeda. Ashley Vigil Claros. Litzy Argueta. Natasha De Paula Vasquez. Karen Jeffrard. Axel Jimenez. Stacy Gomero. Leon Perez. Matias Cabrera Toledo. Kwame Nyanfo. Misael Blanco Hernandez. Osmar Oliveira. Jack Seda. Aslan Velasquez Ventura. Allison Portillo Pena. Jason Bonilla Arevalo. Alba Argueta Ramos. Daniela Guevara Diaz. Yurani Hernandez Laszlo. Brianna Rivera Martinez. Anisuria Drio Soteno. Lucian Yatsena. Sofia Mejia Soto. Maria Alejandra Castaneda Bautista. Jackson Argueta. Thomas Arroyo Pena. David Vera Alfonso. Sheldon Ruiz Araldo. Joseph Somar. Brianna Taylor. Alexandra Rodriguez Castro. Anthony Cruz. Jennifer Funes Hernandez. Kimberly Rosales Rivera. Annabelle Umenzor. Dayami Umenzor. Ava Ray Rojas. Athena Ayala. Natalie Salazar Mojica. Matthew Reyes Maldonado. Alex Mejia Garcia. Carla Tejeda Baez. Kaylee Castro. Madeline Alcantar Aguilar. Chelsea Saavedra. Isabella Perdomo. Karen Castellon. Sarah Hashemi. Genesis Guzman. Eileen Nunez. Kaylin Herman. Christopher Matos. Jeffrey Chigas. Jorge Ortiz. Rebecca Pisity. Mateo Miranda. Ben Castro. Shayani Picardo. Nasli Paulino. Andy Ake. Emily Ramos. Anna Moratea Meza. Kenenzi Perdomo. And Emily Rodriguez Velasquez. Why don't we give a big round of applause for all of our young authors?
They're just setting up in the back. We're going to open up the curtain 1 second. Okay. And may I reveal the 2024 Young Authors? To take some pictures. We're going to stand here for a minute or two. We're going to take some pictures ourselves. I invite the dignitaries to fill in on the sides, and we'll take some group photos. I don't know. Winners, smile! I don't know. I was trying to. She's not looking. She took a couple pictures.
You didn't get in.
I'm good.
Take another picture. Take one more picture with Trish.
Well, the parents are taking them.
I know.
With her.
No, all of
us. No, with all of us, yes.
Yeah, can you get us all in? Can you get all of us? She will.